One of the most difficult things, I think, when adapting a great book is, you know, it's a great book. It's also, if I was to shoot, it would be about 7 hours long, around 7 hours. We know there's that wonderful play being done by a company that just reads the entire book or performs the entire book. It's 7 hours long. We had to do 2 hours. So one of the most difficult things in the process is what to let go. Now, Craig and I began that very early on with, we might love the scene where Nick goes, you know, with downstairs afterwards after Myrtle's apartment and ends up strangely looking at photographs, you know, with Mr. McKee, you know, and then is it the train station, and then, you know, or where Myrtle buys the police car. We might like it, we might love it, but can we do without it? So that's our first job. And now we're focused down to scenes we must have. Now, I shot a lot of scenes after Gatsby's death. And it was a very painful process of progressively letting them go, because at first I put them all in. And there were a wonderful scene between Joel Edgerton and Toby Maguire, you know, touching, beautiful scene where Gatsby's father comes to the coffin, a scene where Jordan and Nick finally say goodbye. But what I found as I played the film to my colleagues, to my co-collaborators, more and more, that the more we focused after Gatsby's death, just down to the relationship between Nick and Gatsby, the more you realise that that's actually what the film's about. Even more than the relationship between Gatsby and Daisy, it's about Nick trying to work out why this person that everyone looks upon who everyone discards as such immoral trash, is the most hopeful human being he has ever met and is ever likely to meet again. And why this guy he wrote this story about called Gatsby is, in fact, great. This is a sad deletion because actually, I think one of the discoveries of the film is Elizabeth Debicki, and I think her Jordan defines the role in a really fantastic way. I've certainly heard that from other people, and she's a great woman, young woman, and she's a fantastic young actor who I think will have an illustrious career. You know, the problem was that we started to recognize as we were shooting it, and look, I shot farewell scenes between Nick and Jordan.
Property Trust, Caraway speaking.
You weren't very nice to me the other night. However, I do want to see you. I'm at the club in Southampton, but I could come into town if you like.
What happens in the book, and Fitzgerald can do it in the book, Jordan sort of fades away. He says, she was talking on the phone and then about the country club, and then we weren't talking anymore.
I'm sorry, but
I just can't.
I suppose it was a mistake to give a damn about you.
But I did. How careless of me.
There? Nick, are you there?
We had a fading away. I mean, Jordan does fade away. And I don't mean that in a negative sense. It's just that in Nick's mind, he went to the beach on Jordan. Therefore, it was very important, although they did this fantastic kissing scene in the back of what they used to call struggle buggies, which is what they called taxis in the 20s, because young couples used to neck.
They're only the pursued. Pursuing the busy and the tired.
You say the funniest things. Well, I'm not tired or busy, so I guess that just leaves.
Pursued.
So not being able to truly conclude that relationship with Nick, it became clearer and clearer that you needed that to become this very Nick Carraway relationship, in and out. It's an almost relationship. It's an almost they're together. If that became a primary romance, then you had to have a beginning, a middle, and an end, and there simply wasn't enough time to evolve that properly. So whenever I'd play it to audiences, they'd sort of go, oh, they're kissing, and are they on together, and why does it end so abruptly?
It's only 9:30.
No, I've had enough of everyone.
It was about staying on the primary romance. She still loves you. I can tell it's in her voice. And Gatsby goes, no, her voice is full of money. Now, Leonardo performs it really well, but the coupleting of it, it's quite negative about Daisy. It feels negative about Daisy. And even though it was meant to happen out on the path, we probably would have done it differently out there. But the way we played it was, no matter what we did, once Tom goes, right, I know what's going on. We're going to town. Off we go. You need Gatsby to be 100% focused on rescuing Daisy, winning Daisy. It's only about a slap down between Tom and Daisy in cinematic terms. So it was just one of these gorgeous lines which we loved, which we just had to surrender to keep the focus on who will win Daisy. Because if there's any hint that Gatsby felt that disappointed by Daisy, then the audience start to go, does he really care? You're lowering the stakes for Gatsby's desire to win the big slapdown, which is coming up in the plaza, you know, in literally, you know, 2 minutes or 3 minutes.
Mr. Gatsby, will you join us?
Come on, Nick! 2 bottles of whiskey, wrap them in a towel.
She loves you. Her voice is full of it.
No. Her voice is... it's full of money.
One of the things that you can do in a novel beautifully, and that Fitzgerald does beautifully, is that, you know, you read a novel very rarely in one sitting, so you can come back to it. And after Gatsby's death, there's a whole lot of revelation. And, you know, I think in the novel, it's the next... After Gatsby's death, it was a blur of reporters and nightmares and blah, 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 blah. And then suddenly everyone abandons Gatsby and Nick even goes and sees Wolfsheim.
I can't.
But you were his friend.
When a man gets killed, I never like to get mixed up. I say, let us learn to show our friendship for a man when he's alive, not after he's dead.
And you realize just how shallow people are. Everyone has a reason why to abandon him. And then, all of a sudden, boom, we shot a wonderful scene with a scene with a beautiful actor, Ralph Cottrell, where all of a sudden Gatsby's father's there.
What do you want?
Herzog? Who is it?
I told you, my name is...
Gats.
Yeah, I'm Jimmy's father.
You know, we was broke up when he run off from home. And ever since he made a success, he was very generous with me.
Thank you.
has this other great piece where he shows a copy of Hopalong Cassidy, and in it you see that James Gatz has written Be Better to Parents, Work Out, Learn About Electricity. You know, he's got ambition. He's got a vision of himself for the future.
If he'd have lived, he'd have helped build up this country. This is a book he had when he was a boy. It just shows you. Rise from bed. 6 a.m. Dumbbell exercise and wall scaling. 6:15 to 6:30.
The only problem with this is, apart from the fact that it was drawing away from the Nick Gatsby, was that we've learned all these things already. And we couldn't see that until we'd actually done it. So however touching the scene was, really it was confusing this re-internalizing of Nick. We see, this is something you do in cinema, we see young Gatz very early on when Nick Carraway says his real name was James Gatz. We see a little boy already with vision, reaching up, having a vision. So we know this. We know he was born with ambition. We've been told it earlier. So again, it was a very, very hard decision, and it was in the film for a very long time.
Study electricity.
Baseball and sports, 4:30 p.m. Practice elocution and poise, 5 p.m. Study new inventions, 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. Read one improving book per week. Save money. Be better to parents.
As the rain fell, all I could think was that Daisy didn't even send a flower.
At one stage, we had tried an elaborate scene at a train station where Nick came and confronted them all, and it really wasn't like that in the book. And in fact, in the book, there's a moment when Nick sees Tom later. And what's really present in that scene, and I think it's actually wonderfully touched upon in this version, is that you get the idea that Tom just got, he's moved on.
After Gatsby's death, New York was haunted for me. Distorted beyond correction, echoes of music and laughter drifted out of Gatsby's garden and found me in my dreams. So I drank, I cracked up. And then, one day in late October...
Shakespeare! Nick! You won't even shake my hand. Gatsby had it coming. Lethal dust in your eyes, Nick. Just like he did with Daisy. He was a tough one, though. He ran over Myrtle like he would run over a dog. It didn't even stop his car.
There was nothing I could say except the one unutterable fact that it wasn't true.
You're crazy! Crazy as hell!
They were careless people, Tom and Daisy. They smashed up things and people and then retreated back into their money and their vast carelessness and let other people clean up the mess they had made.
Again, the pool scene was a scene that just needed, for all its value, it distracted from this idea of just going back into Nick's internalized experience.